This is the monthly Minnesota Christian Songwriters meeting, and today we're spotlighting Paul Nye, and we came from a long distance, and I met Paul through online meetings at the Minnesota Association of Songwriters, and you know, both of us are not only Christian songwriters, but we write secular songs also. And I found Paul to be a prolific songwriter, in my opinion, a very talented multi-instrumentalist. He brought some albums here today, and he's a recording artist, and I was very impressed with a couple of his CDs that I've listened to. And so anyway, welcome, Paul. If you can tell us a little bit about the beginnings as a songwriter, and who were your influences in the beginning? How did you start out knowing you were a songwriter?
I'm not sure. I wrote a song when I was like 15 or 16. My dad was an evangelical physicist. Dichotomy awards. Worked for University of Minnesota physics. So pretty analytical type, and so pretty proud of my song. I was the black sheep in the family. My five siblings are all classically trained, and I went to rock and roll. So I wrote this song that I was pretty proud of, and I think it was a gospel song, and I thought it was going to be really a big hit, being, you know, idealistic. It's called "Adam Is My Granddad." Really profound. And I played it for my dad. I said, "What do you think, Dad?" And he goes, "Yeah, you know, it's the first song. Keep working at it." And I'm going, "What?" Yeah, I thought I'd get more out of my dad. And I said, "Dad," and so I went for this one thing that I knew even my own father couldn't refute. He couldn't come back on this one. I said, "Dad, God gave me this song." And it was cool. He was like this. He's reading his paper. He goes, "Well, son, maybe he gave it to you because he didn't want it." He was a great dad. And I'll be doing that song later. So, but I just want to say, I don't think there are many songwriters in existence today that would go that low after writing 1,000+ songs, and do the first one, which is probably the worst song I ever wrote. And I mean, that begs the question, why would you do that? I just kind of give a frame of reference, I guess.
Did you have any artists that you were inspired by, or, you know, to?
I think it was secular music and my youth group at church that got me in that, because right away I started playing bass. Bass is my main instrument. And one of the girls in my youth group wanted me to get in a band that her girlfriend's younger brother was starting, so that I could be a witness to them. And I struggled with that. I was 17, I think, 16, 17. And my father had been really hard on my older brother, David, who wanted to play in a polka band. And he wouldn't let him do it because they did secular music. And so, and my brother David went off the deep end and just really got into drugs and that. Well, he wasn't going to do that with me, so he let me do it. But I played this band, and I taught myself how to play bass. And he would say stuff like me coming from playing at a church someplace. And he says, "Where'd you play tonight?" I said, "Oh, playing St. Peter's Episcopal." "Oh, did you do any hymns?"
Yeah.
I said, "No." But anyways, that's so I got the lecture from him a lot, but I knew that my father supported me a lot, because I heard from his students that were my youth workers. They were saying, "Your dad sure is proud of you, Paul." I said, "Wow, I had no idea." You know, so I heard to the grapevine. And then there was one time I had two great aunts that were the first female doctors to graduate from Yale Medical School and University Medical School. And they really came down hard on me for having long hair and listening to rock music. And I had an aunt that ran Marie, what was the Skid Row mission? It's Marie Sandvik Center down on Franklin and Doris. So they all kind of came down hard on me because they were believers in that. And what really spoke to me the most was when they were criticizing me. And my dad pretty much gave a piece of his mind.
All right.
And that was when I first heard him say, "He's my son, I'm proud of his music, and he can do what he wants with his music. Keep your mouth shut."
Mm-hmm.
You know? Mm-hmm.
So,
anyways, that was that. That's my main earliest influence, I think.
Yeah.
I did stick a car cigarette lighter in my nose when I was in second grade, and I found out I had a voice.
Okay. So, can you tell us like a little bit? You know, when you are inspired to write a song, what's your process? Usually, you ask people, is it lyrics or music first, or both at the same time?
If it's music, it usually comes from a commercial. Good Morning America.
Mm-hmm.
I catch a little thing in the morning. I'm getting up and thinking, oh, I like that groove. Yeah. And I run to my studio or I get my phone on, go, you know, just do that. I never have writer's block. I just observe and I just look at stuff. And so the challenge for me is coming up with something that's really, you know, in songwriting they say, don't be clever. I don't like that because I love clever.
Yeah. Yeah, me too.
I love clever. One of my favorite songwriters, Craig Carruthers, was a very successful songwriter. I do a lot of his songs. He is really clever and stuff. Bruce Coburn, Hugh Prestwood, those guys, you know, you listen to a song and at the end of the song, you're just kind of like, wow,
this is mine.
I didn't see that coming.
Mm-hmm.
So I like doing stuff like that. I like things that surprise people. I like unexpected. I like taking on topics that people won't touch. I like taking words and twisting them around.
Yes.
One of the ones I did recently was called "It's All Your Fault," and I was thinking, what if we went to heaven and we got blamed for someone being there? It was our fault that they were there. It's a different look on how we use that word.
Mm-hmm.
And people in Minnesota Association of Songwriters critiqued me and they said, "You're using the word wrong." I said, "Well."
It's kind of a new way.
You're still blaming a person. You know, what would it be like if you get to heaven and some person walks up to you and they say, "You don't know me, but you know, in 1992, you came to my college and you said something, and you said something. That started me on the road to Jesus. And so I'm here because you, and it's all your fault. I'm blaming you." I thought, what a great thing to get blamed for.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm talking about. So it's just like taking language and kind of messing with it.
I've heard you talk in the past about using Jesus per minute, you know, and I'm really guilty of this myself. But can you speak to songwriters how they can break out of a certain mold? And you did a little bit. You like to use new ways of looking at things, you know, but how they can come up with more original ideas, you know, do you have any?
Well, I kind of compartmentalize things. Like the worship music I write is a whole different, it's a whole different type of writing.
Okay.
I tend to write values of scripture. Kindness, love, taking the approach of don't return hate for hate or evil for evil. Surprise people. And when people do something bad to you, just reach out to them. So the music is kind of that way too. And then I also do some introspective stuff. The rule that I've always gone by is know your audience and surprise them. Don't take them for granted, and try to stay away from Christian cliches. There's a website now that has all the modern Christian cliches, and I use a lot of them. And I thought, wow,
I'll be singing a lot of those today.
I might even.
Yeah,
but you know, there's power in that name.
Yeah,
in that name.
That's a cliche right there.
So I know you have a website, paulnye.com,
yeah.
Right? All your music is there, and people can go and listen to that, or pretty much.
They can see, I have videos there mostly, but you can find the links from that to Spotify and all the other platforms that are out there. CD Baby, okay. I think that's my distributor, so.
And I know you're a very good recording artist, which we'll probably hear some today, but can you talk a little bit about your recording? What you lay down the drum first, or bass, or?
I cut my teeth on GarageBand, and I had troubles with it one time, and I called Apple up and support, and I'll tell them my problem. They said, wait a minute, let's back up a little bit. What are you doing with GarageBand? What are you trying to do? And I said, well, I've got this thing, and I've got 40 tracks. Wait, stop. You're saying you have 40 tracks in GarageBand? I said, yeah. How do you do that?
No.
I said, the program is not designed for that. I said, I don't know what. I use Logic, and basically what I do is I'll just go down and I'll take a single mic, and I'll find the click that I want. And I always record with the click, and then I'll record a scratch vocal with the guitar, just get it down. And then I'll listen to it and see if I want to make changes, speed it up, slow it down. And then I'll drag in a drum track, and just a simple drum track, because I like hearing drums. It's more of a live feel than a click.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So you can get the feel and the nuances of the song. And then I'll get the drums in there. And once I get the drums down, then I get my two mics that I put 12th fret and on the bridge. And then I record the acoustic on separate tracks, two separate tracks, listening in the background. Then once I get that done, I'll redo the vocal, just another scratch vocal so it's separated, and then I'll delete that original track. And then I start building from there. And usually I'll come in with bass, and a lot of times what I'll do is I'll solo the kick and the bass and acoustic guitar and a little bit of vocal, so I'm not hearing the whole. So that way you can get right in the pocket with the kick and the bass. Well, a lot of the songs that I listen to that are done on home studios, the pocket of a song is just, it's so loose. And when you're building tracks by yourself and you don't have a band, it's really easy. If you're not right on the money and just spot on tight, everything after that is gonna get, if you're off just a little bit on one thing, it's gonna multiply that effect. And then the song is disjointed, and it's just like, what's going on in this song? It's just like, you know, overplaying here, or here's the kick and the bass comes in here. And I look at it like a microscope. If you take something and you look at a track here like this, and your kick and your bass is lined up there, and you expand that track, and all of a sudden they start shifting like this. Mm-hmm. That's what you're hearing. So you have to kind of bring it in. There's a lot of ways you can do it. You can easily use quantization, but I prefer just to go back and just do punch-ins and just get it right and just play it and just build the foundation of the song with the kit and your rhythm tracks, so they're really tight. And that's been hard for me, really hard, but that's the thing I learned from Scott. Yeah. So that's how I kind of started. And then I started adding instruments on there, and then and I don't know where to stop. I'll have like 8, 9, 10 electric guitars on a track sometimes.
Right.
And layers. I love Hammond, so Hammond is on everything.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Yeah, I love your recordings. So anyway, we're going to get on with the meeting, but we appreciate you.
Thank you for your time. Appreciate
you talking with us today. And we'll probably do this again with other people in the group, so be ready. It'll be a surprise. No.
Really? You're going to surprise us.
You're on.